Back here, 615 Sessions Podcast, powered by Tennessee Tickets. A to Z Sports, Nashville.com. Friends returning to the podcast, Braden Gall and Ali Collum, kind enough to give us some time on this Wednesday as we're recording it, but for your ears and YouTube viewers on Thursday. Friends, it's good to see you. Ali, been too long. Last time you were here in studio and we were shit-talking Brent about Tennessee.
Way too long.
Braden, we have much to discuss in the world of college football, which is why both of you are here. We need both the perspective of hardened media member and Bammer in this conversation. We need both of these opinions in the mix.
You can't have a college football conversation without a Bammer. That's just part and parcel of the last 15 years of the game. So,
what's the license plate say?
Alabama.
That's right. That's where we are. That's 1,000% the case. Okay. We are going to talk about Alabama and other college football programs, particularly in the SEC, who have allowed their student athletes back on the campus. The positive COVID-19 tests have begun. We're going to talk about college football season, what the threshold should be for these kinds of tests, and whether any of us would be comfortable going to a college football game. Ali has Gundy takes that we have to get off her chest because she's ready to go and talking about the crazy mulleted man down there at Oklahoma State. And also face swaps with SEC head coaches as women. Much, much important topics of discussion for today's podcast. So let's start with the good stuff, though, or depending on how – let's start with the progress that we have with actual college football. SEC athletes were allowed back onto campus on June 8th. We have seen several schools, including Ali's Crimson Tide, come up with positive tests. Your initial reaction to the students being back on campuses, back in workout facilities, and now the positive tests start popping up. What did you make, Ali, when you saw this come across your timeline?
Honestly, figure there would be positive tests. I feel like the more testing that's going on, the more people have it. And I think there are more forms, you know, than the super urgent, like whatever going on. I expect there to be more people than I think we had 5 tests positive.
Correct.
And, you know, I guess they're following all the guidelines that they can follow. And if we want to have a football season, I feel like you have to get the kids in there at some point. And I mean, they have great medical care, so it might be better for some of them to be there getting that medical care. It's tricky. I don't even know where I would start with, you know, games. I know there have been a lot of different talks between athletic directors, and even Alabama opens with USC. And my first thing was when California announced that they have another 3-month quarantine, I was like, oh my God, football season. And then I remembered that they were a private university. But then I think, okay, you can have the game, but are we not going to have fans? Because I feel like NFL can function a little better without fans. Like, they would be able to have a season without fans. College football, not so much.
Braden, the positive tests were going to be a given. Like, this was going to happen as soon as they got back to campus. It's just whether they're showing symptoms. How much can they contain the spread within the athletes actually being back? But, for example, Alabama, Nick Saban, 68. How do you get little Nicky around all these disease-ridden millennials that are COVID-19 positive? Can you risk the great one?
Well, and of course, the fastest way to get people to buy in the state of Alabama that COVID's a real thing is tell them that there's a risk that Nick Saban might catch it. Birmingham, Tuscaloosa, Decatur, all these places in Alabama are seeing big rises. But again, that's not new. I mean, that's across the country. I think the most interesting development in all of this are these sort of waiver. They're not really waivers. They're like pseudo waivers that coaches and programs and athletic directors are asking their players to sign. Like, I will act like a volunteer. I will act like a, you know, an Oklahoma Sooner or whatever. And I'm just not sure where the legal ramifications fall from like a liability standpoint. Like, if I'm a parent, and again, I've said this to you before, Buck, like if I'm a parent and my kid tests positive, you know, to Ali's point, there could be in much better hands and much better situation, but not everybody. And so who knows how parents feel about all this and the difference between the professionals and the collegiate athletes are collective bargaining power. The pro guys have collective bargaining power that says, here's what we're going to deal with. Here's the procedures. Here's the cost. Here's X, Y, and Z. And it's all laid out in a contract. And that's just, none of that exists in college football. And so I think the good news for people is people in the SEC care so much about their football and other places too. But I get asked all the time, like, what happens? Are we not going to have football? And I go, no, that's never going to happen. Like, even if it costs you a couple million bucks or a couple hundred million bucks, Alabama fans will make sure that Alabama football is still a thing forever. It's never going to change. That's the same for LSU and Florida and Tennessee and Georgia. So, you know, it may look a little different this year, but I still have faith that there's going to be some semblance of football on a field in some capacity. The question is, how safe is it? Is there liability? Are parents involved? You know, how much does it cost? There's a lot of things that go into that.
Allie, you go to these games religiously throughout the course of the season, whether it's the playoff games that Alabama was making, not most recently, but that's okay. it's a tried and true tradition for SEC fans, as Braden's talking about. You're going to support these teams, and it's really not the Power Five that people are concerned about, but how safe do you need to feel, I guess, to be comfortable going to an Alabama football game in the fall, if they're even allowed?
I mean, for me, I have parents that are like mid-50s, so when this started, my whole fear was bringing something to them. And I was actually quarantined with them the whole time. But I was like, you're not going to the grocery store at first. You're not doing anything. I would not be worried going to a game, but I would be worried about like who I would give it to that, you know, is not a younger, healthy person. And it's happening to younger, healthy people that, you know, shocking things are happening. But I think with being back in Nashville, I've been to some restaurants and, you know, socialized a little bit, but taking the temperature is now a normal thing. Wearing a mask is a normal thing some places. I feel like those are the things that they'll have to implement if you're going to have that many people, because there have been talks of, are you going to give season ticket holders the first go if you're not going to have a full stadium? How are you going to regulate that? People are going to get
mad. Is it a lottery? How do you decide who gets to go and who doesn't?
I mean,
money, folks. It's an easy answer. Whoever has the most money will get in. That's it.
1,000%.
Like the students, I'm like, man, how do you tell what half of them they can't go in the student section?
Well, very easily, they have decidedly less money than everybody else who's trying to attend these games. Yeah, but sure. Your point is well taken. Braden, what do you need to know about college football's plan to return from coronavirus to make you comfortable with the idea of fans being there?
That there's a plan. There's a lot of places in this country I know that have no plan, and it feels like that's the areas where I'm most concerned. And I think
baseball.
Even to Allie, what you were saying about being around Nashville, and just like, there are certain places right now that like my wife and I would feel comfortable going because we know the people that either run the establishment or we sort of know where they stand on everything and how they've handled it, the people that work there and how they've handled it. And there's certain places I would go, and then there's certain places I just am not going to get food from because I just don't, I know that they're not handling it or taking it seriously at least. And so I think it depends on, you know, and I don't think in the SEC in particular or anywhere in college football, you're going to have some guidelines, right, where Greg Sankey is going to send down on from on high protocols, and each organization and university is going to have to probably follow some basic level of implementation of protocol. And I would be prepared for 60 or 70% of stadiums to be empty. Like, I wouldn't be shocked if we're, you know, if Bryant Denny's got, you know, 30,000 people in it for a home game, or Neyland Stadium has 30,000 people in it for a home game. And also depends on what happens between now and then. Like, if cases continue to go up across the country, but we learn more about it, you know, it just depends on what happens. I think we're in a sort of a wait and see mode, as we have been this whole time. But I want to know, if I'm going to a game, again, to your point, Allie, like, I've got in-laws who are immunocompromised, and I'm not worried about myself, even though you guys both probably think I'm ancient. I'm not worried about myself, but like, I'm not worried about my two kids either. And I'm not worried about my wife, but I'm worried about her parents for sure. And if we happen to, you know, come in contact with somebody. So I think it's all about how it looks and feels. And if people are taking it seriously, like, I don't want to go to Florida right now. Like, I'm not going to Florida, like, where people are just running around like nothing's happening. And so again, there's a balance. This is the whole thing has been a balance between taking it seriously and being smart, not overreacting, but also like wearing, like you said, Allie, wearing masks works. We've learned that it works. It's one of the few things we've learned. And so if everyone has to wear a mask to be in the stands, okay, that makes me feel a little bit better.
Allie, I saw you visibly cringe at the idea of 30,000 people in Bryant Denny Stadium.
I mean, if we have to do it, we have to do it. I just want a season. But I am glad that we're kind of doing a wait and see thing, because I guess maybe it was Oklahoma, or I can't remember exactly where, decided they weren't doing anything through September. And it was like May when they decided that. And I was like, wait a minute, this is changing daily. We don't know, you know, what's going to happen. So I am glad it's kind of a wait and see issue.
Yeah, that's the best that we can do at this point. Let's talk about actual football, because Braden, last time you were here, we didn't talk really about actual football. It's about constant things happening in society that directly affect our sports. But I think now is the time to discuss what may lie ahead on the field, whether there's fans or not. So I saw that Alabama picked up its third ESPN 300 recruit today. It's a wide receiver, Christian Leary, who the Tide has recently acquired. Tennessee is beating the brakes off of everybody in the midst of a global pandemic when it comes to recruiting in a way that Alabama fans are probably a little salty about. They're starting to lose recruiting battles to Big Orange. This is obviously in reference to the 2021 recruiting class and future programs or future efforts that these programs are making to build. But, Allie, you see Jeremy Pruitt out here scooping you guys in a lot of instances with the level of talent they've been able to add. Do you have mixed emotions about your boy?
I mean, we talked about Jeremy Pruitt last time, and I said I was expecting this from him. I'm not shocked one bit, and I would like for the third weekend in October to get a little spicier these days. So I'm not sad about it. I'm not worried. Proud of Jeremy Pruitt, but Alabama's going to keep doing our thing. So,
Braden, is this actually tangible? Like what they're doing? It's so early in this process that the biggest issue that they will now have is holding on to, I mean, they've got the number two recruiting class in the country right now. That's obviously not going to stand pat. They will have difficulty keeping these guys committed. But as this evolves, or at least where it is right now, are you surprised with what Jeremy Pruitt has been able to do at your alma mater?
No. I mean, one of the only things we knew about Jeremy Pruitt when he took the job was that he was a really good recruiter. Like, we knew that when he got the gig. We had no idea if he could, you know, run an entire program or a $200 million, you know, CEO. That's a different thing altogether. And there's still mixed reviews on whether or not he's going to win. I mean, they were 1-4 and he was on the hot seat last year. So they've only beaten one team in 2 years with a winning SEC record. And that was Kentucky 2 years ago. So there's still a long way to go. And I'm kind of pissed, Buck, because you said we were going to talk about football on the field. And
then I was recruiting.
You're asking me about 17-year-olds and like where they're going to go. And like, I don't care. Like wake me when don't tell me about the labor pains. Show me the baby. And let's get to signing day. Cause you're right. They're not going to finish number two. There's just no way you need, I don't know the exact number off the top of my head, but you need somewhere in the 18 to 20 4- and 5-star recruit range to finish 1 and 2. And that's not going to be where Tennessee's class is going to be. If I'm Alabama fan, if I'm Georgia fan, I'm not overly worried about recruiting this year with Tennessee. It takes years to stack talent on top of talent on top of talent before, like, Georgia is just now starting to catch Alabama as far as talent goes. And it's taken Kirby Smart 4 years to do it. So it takes a long time to catch Nick Saban and the machine that he's got rolling right now. So I, you know, Georgia is the team I'd be looking at as far as talent and ability. Tennessee's still got 2 or 3 more years of this before they can start claiming that they're anywhere near the upper echelon of the SEC.
Do you fear Georgia at all, Allie? Are you in that phase of – yeah, the eye roll. Oh, my God. Go ahead.
Georgia obviously has Kirby, which they took from us. They now have Scott Cochran, which they took from us. They're just trying to do what we do, and they're not trying to do it in an original way. Oh. They're just trying to be a carbon copy of Alabama, and it's clearly not working for them when it comes down to championship games. Georgia and Alabama play at home this year, and I will be upset if I don't get to be there, because that is going to be insane. Especially because Scott Cochran was such a huge part of Alabama's football program. I mean,
and if I could just clarify for the audience, that's the Alabama strength coach that is now going to Georgia to be a coach on the field.
Incredibly charismatic and just a huge part of like the personality of Alabama football. So it'll be interesting to see that game, especially this year, and because it's during regular season. That'll be crazy.
On the field, though, which player? Because they've got the machine is still rolling. Like Nick Saban, there may be a few people like getting a little closer to the throne, but he's still sitting atop it. Him and Dabo kind of co-chairing at this point atop college football, and we could talk about Dabo's issues ad nauseum. But which player? Because there's a lot of talent left on that offense, in particular. A lot of youth that was forced into early playing time on defense last year. Who are you most excited to see on the field for the Crimson Tide next year?
We get Najee Harris back, so yeah. I think that's huge for us. We did have a couple guys offensively that stayed, which I was kind of shocked about. For a couple years, we just had so many rolling over going to the NFL early so quick. And so I was excited about that, but I do think our quarterback battle with Mac Jones and Bryce Young is going to be interesting too, because there's all this Bryce Young hype. He's going to be better than Tua. He's so great. And then we all bought into Mac Jones when Tua got hurt. And some people are saying, you know, Bryce will be starting by the Georgia game. So I think that's going to be interesting for us.
Is that actual buy-in, or are you just going along with the cult? Like, are you just saying, okay, Mac Jones is the guy. We must follow Mac Jones. Mac Jones, roll tide.
No, I mean, if you look at my Twitter from the Iron Bowl last year, I was going pretty hard for Mac.
Okay.
Just because he stepped into such a huge role. I mean, Tua was at the top of college football, you know, greatest player Alabama's ever had. And then you have to come in when the greatest player ever to a lot of people gets an injury. And he just did it with complete swag. He was just like, what's up? I'm Mac Jones. I'm here. And I think he just earned a lot of respect from people for doing that. So I think that'll be an interesting little quarterback battle, because Tua's younger brother left and went to Maryland.
Correct.
So he's out of Alabama now.
And if you want more of those Alabama football takes, you can, of course, follow Allie at Allie Collum Music, where she stays feuding with middle-aged and older, it seems, other SEC fans. It's just it's why we love
her. She's not wrong, though. Mac Jones should be the starter, so. I mean, if Bryce Young is the starter, you do have somebody as good as Tua on your hands, right? Like it's the same thing at Tennessee with Harrison Bailey. It's the same thing with Emory Jones at Florida. These guys all have starting quarterbacks in front of them. And if the guy who's younger is good enough to be the starter, that's a good problem to have. It means that he's that good. Mac Jones threw for over 4 Bills on the road against Auburn. Like, it's not like he's got the best offensive line in America. You got 2 first-round draft picks at wide receiver still. Jalen Waddle's the most dominant player in space with a football in his hands in the entire country. Alabama's going to maul people this year if they play football games. So I'm not worried about the quarterback position in Alabama. That's the last thing I'm worried about.
Well, where are you worried about the quarterback position in the SEC? Because, as you mentioned, Tennessee has an interesting situation. Jarrett Garantano is an entrenched starter. Those are typically hard to unseat, unless you're someone with the talent level of Harrison Bailey. Now, this whole virtual spring and summer for college football complicates the idea that somebody could take over at the helm of that team. But that's kind of, Braden, I think for them to take a substantial step, I think that's the one thing that you're really not certain about, is that can they get consistent quarterback play? Not even high-level quarterback play. Can Jarrett Garantano relax and not pull an audible and try to sneak it against Alabama when you have a chance in that game, or at least early?
Well, and what's interesting is I had a chance to talk to a bunch of offensive coordinators about how they went about developing their quarterbacks during a pandemic. It's just a totally unique situation. And almost all of them, to a person, which I thought was really interesting, said that they've taken more mental reps and watched more film than ever before during any spring. So if you kind of envision what that looks like for a player, you're on Zoom all day, you're doing demonstrations, you're watching film, you're watching cut-ups. You know, North Carolina, Phil Longo is running Sam Howell through live game reps against NFL defenses. They're all doing really creative stuff. And it means they're all taking way more mental reps, and they might actually be ahead of the game from a mental side of things, which actually could help a player like Jerick Garantano, which you would assume as a guy who's played 30 or 40 games has the fundamentals of the position down. He doesn't need to work on the physical stuff like arm slot, like platform, like footwork, eyes, all that stuff. You would assume that a guy who's that old or that and that experienced, the mental reps would actually help him. So I think there's, you know, he's certainly not entrenched. I'd push back on that word. I mean, he was better coming off the bench as like a relief pitcher last year, which is a really strange thing for a quarterback. But he's played more football than anybody else on that team. And he is sort of the lone position that they're missing. You know, there's some questions in the front seven, but they've got pieces there. The secondary is in good shape. The running back room is really good. The offensive line is one of the best in the league. So if the quarterback position can be consistent, to your point, they can win 8 or 9 games. The question is, you know, is it Jerick Garantano? Is it Harrison Bailey? And back to what I said earlier, you know, just like what happened with Auburn last year, Joey Gatewood and Bo Nix were supposed to go deep into the season. They're going to compete deep into the season as to who's going to be the starter, you know, from Gus Malzahn's mouth. And then Gus Malzahn names Bo Nix the starter like 4 days into practice. And it's because Bo Nix is clearly that good. And it's the same thing I'm saying with Bryce Young or Harrison Bailey or any of these other guys. If you've got a guy who's clearly that good, who belongs in the starting lineup, you know it right away, and you just got to throw him out there. And it may mean you lose a game this year, but it means you're going to be better in the long run. So I think Tennessee's actually in a better situation at quarterback than people think. But it may not be as, you know, in the more traditional sense where you've got an established guy who's just going to make the right decisions. And, you know, they've got a decent room. We don't know what that room looks like quite yet. I would assume going to Oklahoma in week 2, you're going to want Jerick Garantano in the starting lineup on the road in Norman, Oklahoma. After that, by the time you get to Florida in week 4, you might see Harrison Bailey. Who knows? So it's definitely the question mark, but I don't think it's as big of a concern as Tennessee fans are sort of making it out to be, or maybe the opposing teams are making it out to be.
They need some kind of stress in their life, these Tennessee fans. They've had it too good lately. You've had all the positive PR from recruiting. You've had great success because they're the only university finding an additional revenue stream in the midst of a pandemic because they're smart enough to let Barstool come in and brand and market their product out there to the
Dugs, baby, Dugs.
The Barstool.
Coach Dugs.
The knuckle-dragging
burgers,
all of these things, the Barstool army flocks to whatever merchandise you put out there. What have you guys made? Because we're going to talk about Mike Gundy and the stupidity that is taking place elsewhere in the state of Oklahoma. What have you made of the Coach Doug's phenomenon? Like, is that something you guys, as college football fans, have you paid any attention to that at all?
Just from being online and seeing it. And yes, Barstool, people buy into whatever they put out there. And I was so confused at first. I'm like, who is this guy with the mustache that everyone keeps posting?
Yes.
I had to, at one point, it was the night that he was, so the night I got on the Coach Doug's train is when, you know, they were announcing when he was going to change jobs and Texas Tech was playing in the Cotton Bowl, I think. And I had to it took me like 45 minutes. And my wife is a UT grad who is a sports fan. She loves going to games. She knows all about college football. And I still had to explain why 39 or 40,000 people were watching a Twitch show about a fictional football game that's 5 years old.
Correct.
And it's because Coach Doug's puts up burgers, baby. Like, that's what he does. And
50 burgers.
And so he goes to Knoxville, of course, takes the job. And then you've got the to your point, Buck, about like, and Texas Tech did this. Patty Mahomes actually was tweeting about this. Like, to sort of buy into it a little bit and play it up and have fun with it, and kind of, you got to acknowledge that it's sort of a, you know, it's a giant nothing burger, really. But like, there's nothing else for people to do right now. And Tennessee bought into it, and, you know, welcome to Rocky Top. Coach Pruitt puts out a statement. Like, it's pretty good. It's pretty smart and savvy stuff as far as, hey, there's nothing else going on right now. Let's get people to pay attention, because as soon as there's real stuff happening, none of that crap's going to work. Like, you can go do electronic horse racing somewhere else, you know?
I did a post-game show after Doug's failure in the national championship game against Virginia Tech, the team even Butch Jones could conquer. I did a post-game show after 126,000 people watched that live.
On get a life, man.
He was losing by 20 for the majority of that game, losing by 20.
Put on a record, seriously.
The best. Well, and we could. I don't want to spread us too thin, because I want to talk a little bit about music too. But I want to make sure that we get the fire breathing Allie Collum's opinions on Mike Gundy and the stupidity taking place at Oklahoma State. So we will leave the Doug's conversation and pivot to the pain and suffering that Mike got, or excuse me, pain and discomfort that Mike Gundy is apologizing for in a very, very poorly filmed hostage video put out, the second of two hostage videos that Oklahoma State is mandating that he put out, of course, wearing the OAN t-shirt, the One American Network t-shirt that caused great contention with his players, most famously Chuba Hubbard, who is the stud running back for Oklahoma State. You see Mike Gundy all over your digital platforms, Allie, apologizing profusely. Somebody must have gotten to him because it takes a lot to get Mike Gundy to fall in line. But on this particular endeavor, he didn't seem like he had much else to say.
You know, I think with everything going on in the world right now, first of all, we've all been locked up for over 3 months. There's a lot going on. I think as a coach, you should be incredibly careful, especially when you have, I mean, there's so many different personalities, races, everything in a locker room. And when you're profiting off of those athletes, just be incredibly careful with your words, because I've had this conversation with a lot of people lately. I can't validate someone else's feelings. Like, I'm a white girl who's 28 and lives in an apartment in a big city. So if your feelings are hurt over something someone says about your skin color, I can't take that away from you and say, you know, this is not, you can't be sad about that. So I do think, especially if you are in the limelight, like these coaches are, you need to be very respectful, very careful. And I've read every single coach who's made a statement, listened to or read over and over. And I just, it's just cringe.
Just cringeworthy. How could you go ahead, Allie?
Well, and you know, like, an issue happened with Dabo, an issue happened with a couple of other coaches. And it's just,
Just stay out of it. Well, and maybe you can't stay out of it, right? Because we are constantly, and Braden's agreeing with the idea that you can't stay out of it because you are responsible.
You're the highest paid employee in the state. Whether you like it or not, and again, I'm all for coaches and athletes, whatever, using their platform or not. Like, that's fine. You choose what you want to do with your life. Like, that, I'm cool with that. But you have to also understand who you are. And if you're the head coach at Clemson, who's won back-to-back national, or two out of three last national championships, you are the most beloved figure in your community, period. Like, period, whether you like it or not. And so whether you say, hey, I don't think players should get paid, like, that's going to be used against you, whether you like it or not. I mean, if you think Colin Kaepernick was, you know, leave the country when Colin Kaepernick took a knee, like, that's going to be used against you on the recruiting trail because you're the most powerful dude in your state, in your community, in your conference, whatever. And Gundy, the problem with Gundy and Dabo, and both very good coaches, is that they have track records of this stuff. That's the problem, is both of them sort of have like this a little tiny bit of tone deafness when it comes to these types of things. And yes, you have to be careful. And if you're not confident in what you think, just slow down. Now, I think there's a bigger issue going on with Chuba Hubbard and Marvin Wilson down at Florida State calling out his coach as well, Mike Norvell. There's a bigger issue at play here than just race relations and injustice and equality and police brutality and all this stuff, which is all obviously incredibly important. There is a players' rights voice conversation that's taking place right now. This is about players finding their own ability to have a platform and a right to say something, because right now they have, in the last 30 years in college football, you have no right. If you step out of line, you're in deep shit with the coaches. So you, this is the first time we've seen players sort of use their platform and their voice. And so it's a bigger conversation. It's not about what network Mike Gundy watches. We all know, you know, most of us know what OAN's really doing. And if Mike Gundy wants to watch it, who cares? Like, let him watch it. But you better understand, when you talk to a bunch of 18 to 22-year-old black men, that they may not see it the same way as you. So, and for the first time, they're getting the ability to put their voice out there. And I think that's the most important thing through all this, is with name, image, and likeness coming, the ability to generate revenue on your own through your own talents and abilities that these kids deserve and are owed the ability to at least have an opinion outside of the framework of these little feudal dictatorships that these coaches manage. And they control all the information. And frankly, I think coaches would be better off if they let players be themselves Imagine if you're like, Al, you're an Alabama fan. If Nick Saban just let you into the locker room and see all the personalities in the locker room, you'd be a better fan. You'd be more committed to those players because you get to know them more. And instead, these coaches put up this wall and they don't let anybody say anything, no personality. And I think it's a major flaw in college football.
I think I agree to that. You know, I went to school at Alabama, so I was lucky enough to be friends with a lot of those guys. And I think if you just listen, and I think a lot of coaches do try to do that, but you're right with the name and likeness and, you know, people getting their own opinions out there, especially with athletes being able to have Twitter and all these other things, a lot is about to change. I think the most important thing is just to listen and then frame your own opinion, and everybody has a right to their own opinion, but whether it's on one side or the other, there are going to be, you know, there's going to be backlash from people either way.
Well, it's just a shred of self-awareness. Like Mike, it's not about the t-shirt. It's about what the t-shirt represents. It's not about, right. It's not about what you like to consume in your spare time. It's about your clear inability. And that's writ large in this country, your inability to discern between fact and opinion with things like OAN. That's something that we're all dealing with in the middle of our social media lives. And to your point about the athletes having this platform in a way that they have legitimate power, I was struck by the way that in that first hostage video with Chuba Hubbard and Mike Gundy, very awkwardly apart, framed slightly to the left, if they moved it just a little bit over, they could have gotten the Oklahoma State logo in there perfectly, but this I'm nitpicking, you know, it's just how I am. I look at that in a case where Chuba Hubbard is apologizing for taking it to Twitter and saying, you know, I should have been a man about this. I should have handled it in-house. I should have approached him like a man. No. Buddy, you have the ability to handle this on your terms. You can make it public. You want to go about making it public. It's just for so long that's been discouraged in football locker rooms and in football's kind of – that's just the headspace that football as a sport operates in, that you have to keep these things in-house and that it's not it somehow makes you less of a man to draw attention to what is clearly considered by the vast majority of us a problem with somebody who's one of the highest paid employees in the state being this ill-informed or this tone deaf about the time that we are currently in.
I don't think anything's
been
happening. Just listen, if I nailed the dismount, you can tell me I nailed the dismount. It's okay to give me a little love every once in a while, Braden.
You did.
Allie Collum, you can follow her at Allie Collum Music. The single, Before You Hate That Town, is available on all of your music streaming platforms. Make sure you check our girl out. She's out here crushing it, releasing music in the midst of a global pandemic. What's that like, by the way? How the hell is that going?
Honestly, I'm pretty upset that I missed my release party because I do love a party. I had it all planned, but I went back and forth about releasing it during the pandemic, and I was like, you know what? Nobody has anything else to do right now than listen to music, so we're releasing it. I did it totally independent. I'm not with the label, so it's done really, really well for that. I've been really pleased, and we wrote my second single today that will hopefully be out mid-August. So it's been fun. It's been weird. Zoom rights or Zoom everything is weird, you know, Zoom rights, Zoom podcasts, all of it. But I did get to do a lot of radio work, so that was fun, but we'll see.
Yeah. Well, mid-August is when you can check that out. Braden Gall, Athlon Sports, Sirius XM Radio, ESPN Radio, when the occasion calls for it. You can follow him on Twitter, at Braden Gall. Buddy, you have any parting shots, parting thoughts to leave the good people with on your most recent appearance?
Oh, man, Indy's the way to go. Way to go, Allie. Stay true to the art and don't let anybody tell you what to do. Go full Sturgill on him every single time. I don't let anybody tell me
what to do.
I love that. So, buy the magazine, of course. AthlonSports.com is the website. We a lot of men and women worked really hard to put that together for everybody out there, and go get you some reading material for the next couple of weeks. So while you're listening to some music, why don't you grab a magazine too? AthlonSports.com.
That's all you got to do. Allie Collum and Braden Gall kind enough to give us some of their time.